Hi everyone, welcome to our reptile physiology video. By the end of this video, you'll be able to describe the structures and functions of all of these systems in reptiles: integumentary, skeletal, cardiovascular and respiratory, digestive, and nervous. So we'll start with the integumentary system, which in reptiles is scales. So scales are formed from the epidermis of reptiles. In general, scales of reptiles are dry and scaly, and there's multiple layers which helps prevent water loss. The number and arrangement of the epidermal scales is species specific, and you can actually, in some cases, we use like the number and the arrangement of scales to identify species to species. So there's certain like the scutes of turtles, we look at those to tell one species apart from another. With the skinks, we look at the scales along their mouth to determine, to differentiate one species from another. In snakes, the size and shape of scales is related to locomotion. So you see over here that there are smooth scales in some snake species and keeled scales in other snake species. The keeled scales have like a ridge in the middle. So you see here, these are keeled, these are smooth. Smooth snakes generally stay on the ground and are fast, so like a black racer. Whereas keeled scales you usually see in snakes that can climb trees, so more like the eastern rat snake. So squamates, which includes snakes and lizards, have continual growth of their epidermis, of their scales and skin, and they shed continuously. That outer layer is called the stratum corneum, and it gets replaced gradually in some species. So in lizards, generally that replacement is gradual. So this is a green and old. Doesn't it look pathetic? Like it's got some weird disease. It's just shedding. Pieces kind of flake off here and there. It's not like one continual piece like we see in snakes, where you get the nice snake skin that's shed off all in one piece. That's called ecdysis. What happens in snakes is that when it's time to shed, their blood pressure shoots up, their head expands and busts through that skin that's ready to shed off. Turtles shed their scutes, and you can see one being shed here, but they shed them not all at once. You see a couple getting ready there. So sometimes you'll see a turtle with one or two that are peeling off, but it's not like all of them come off in a solid sheet. Glands are an important part of the integumentary system in reptiles, and there's some different kinds of glands. There can be musk glands that emit scent for signaling. We have the mud and musk turtles. The musk turtle, it's commonly referred to as a stink pot, so they have really strong musk glands to mark territories and communicate to conspecifics. Femoral glands emit pheromones to attract mates or mark territory. And so you see, this is the same species of lizard, a male and a female. You can see the femoral glands. And so pheromones are sent out to attract mates through those femoral glands. There are some species that have preanal glands that emit reproductive hormones. Some use the cloaca for scent marking, and then some have nucodorsal glands, which are near the neck, and those are for defense against predators. There are some interesting modifications in different species related to the epidermis. So claws are an extension of the epidermis. They're made of keratin. It can be used for climbing, for digging, securing prey in some cases. Rattle is part of that stratum corneum, but it doesn't get shed. So the rattle stays even after the skin is shed. Horns can be bony projections of the skull covered with the scaly integument, or sometimes they're just modifications of the integument. So this is a horned rattlesnake, and this is all just integument. There's not actual like skeleton involved in those horns. this shell in turtles is made of large bony dermal plates. And remember, in the carapace, which is the dorsal portion of the shell, it is actually fused to the skeleton, to the rib. So it's part of the skeleton, but it's also part of the epidermis. The plastron is that ventral piece of the shell. And then the part that connects the two, it's called the lateral bridge. It unites the two shell parts. Chromatophores are the cells that hold pigment. So this green enamel looks green right now, right? But probably most of us have seen green enamels that look brown. And that's because they have these chromatophores, cells that disperse pigment granules. And the chromatophores can move and shift, which causes the color we see to change. That's important for camouflage, for sexual recognition, for breeding, and it can actually also function for thermoregulation. Moving on to the skeletal system, remember when we talked about reptile evolution and the diapsids and the synapsids and the anapsids, that relates to that temporal fenestra. So on this picture of an alligator skull, we see two temporal fenestra. That means diapsid. Two means die. Crocodile, snakes, lizards are diapsids. So are birds. Turtles are anapsids. There's no holes in this part of the skull. And then mammals are synapsids, where there's one hole. The vertebrae of lizards is interesting. Check out this snake skeleton. Look at how many vertebrae, up to 500 vertebrae can be present in a snake skeleton. The vertebrae can be separated into the precaudal vertebrae. Those are the ones that are before the vent. So the vent is like the exit, also called the cloaca. Before the vent, all the vertebrae have ribs on them. And then vents right around here. After that, no ribs. Those are the postcaudal vertebrae. In a lizard, there are thoracic vertebrae that have ribs and then lumbar vertebrae that don't have ribs, or they might have reduced ribs. Reptiles also have fused sacral vertebrae that support the pelvic girdle and allows them to stand up off the ground. And for some, it allows them to stand at least for a little bit of time on 2 feet. We'll see something similar to that in birds that allows them to stand up. So this fusing of vertebrae close to the pelvic girdle allows for being up off the ground and maybe even for bipedalism. Cardiovascular and respiratory system. So we have that three-chambered heart where the ventricle is incompletely divided, but we have double circulation. So it's pretty efficient because we're pumping blood out to the lungs to pick up oxygen, then pumping again to the rest of the body. There's a little bit of a septum that tries to keep the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood separate in the ventricle, but it's not completely divided. So not super efficient like we'll see in the birds and mammals. The lungs are located in the pleuroperitoneal cavity. And there's one lung that's dinky in snakes. And one that's super long. Why? What's the adaptive advantage of that? Well, snakes are super long, right? If you had them side by side, would that really fit? They're long and skinny. So over time, this adaptation has been selected for where having one long, highly functional lung and the other reduced, not really functional, has been a trait that's helped survival and reproduction. And so it's persisted. So in snakes, it's pretty neat to, if you ever get a chance to dissect a snake and see that there's that one really long lung. So in reptiles, instead of having alveoli like mammals have, they have favioli, which are external subchambers of the lungs. So alveoli are kind of more internal. The favioli are subchambers of the lungs external that do increase surface area for gas absorption. Reptiles still have to use kind of a what is called a force pump system to get air in the lungs. Remember how that buccopharyngeal breathing in amphibians, same kind of thing. They have to force air into the lungs. They don't have a diaphragm the way that mammals do. Some species of reptiles can actually absorb oxygen through their pharynx, cloaca, and their skin. So these are special exceptions for kind of extreme environments, but it is possible. The digestive system. Most reptiles have teeth. Turtles are an exception. They have those beaks with the sharp tomia is kind of the beak. And a lot of times they're a little bit ridged, so it seems almost like teeth, but they don't actually have teeth. There's some different kinds of dentition that you see across different reptiles. Acrodont dentition is where the teeth are attached to the biting edges of the jaw. Pleurodont is where they're attached to the inner side of the jawbone. Thecodont you see in crocodiles where the teeth are rooted in sockets. Snake teeth are pretty neat that they're recurved, meaning they curve backward, and that's so as to kind of be able to hold on to prey so it doesn't escape. So it's once it's in there, it can't go back the other way. The sides of many snakes' jaws are, so the mandible is the bottom part of the jaw, and a lot of times it's attached with a really stretchy ligament so that those jaws can open super wide. So even though their head is only so big, it can open up like almost bigger than their whole head. Some snakes have an extra folding strut that suspends the lower jaw on a hinge, so that makes it allows it to open even wider. And most reptiles have polyphyodont dentition, which means there's a constant and steady replacement of teeth. So whereas mammals have just two sets, right? We have our baby teeth and our adult teeth. Reptiles will keep replacing them through life. Now, the fun teeth, venomous snakes. So there's two different kinds of teeth in venomous snakes. The pteroglyphs example being, at least the only example on our list, is the eastern coral snake. They have rigid fangs that fit into pockets in the outer part of the jaw. So they just kind of fit right in there. They don't retract. So they aren't super long like the pit viper fangs that retract. In the coral snake, the venom is a neurotoxin, so it's paralyzing. It can actually paralyze the respiratory system and lead to death. The selenoglyphs, so these are the pit vipers from our list, they're highly specialized fangs that fold back into the mouth. So this is an example here, this picture, they flip out and then they can fold back so that they can actually close their mouth without piercing through the bottom part of their mouth. So they fold back, they flip out when they're ready to strike, and the venom is hemolytic. So it actually breaks apart blood cells and that leads to death. The venom glands are modified labial salivary glands. Pretty cool. We have a number of venomous snakes in North Carolina and on our list. So good to know them, good to be able to identify them and to admire them from afar. All right, the digestive system. So you start out with the mouth and the tongue. The reptile tongue is more developed than the amphibian tongue. It's actually a sensory organ. Turtles can't stick their tongue out. Their tongue is attached to the oral cavity floor, and so it doesn't ever come out of their mouth. So if you ever wondered why you didn't see a turtle stick out its tongue, it can't. Snakes and some lizards have a long and skinny flexible tongue that's forked at the end for extra sensing of what's out there. When you see tongue flicking in reptiles, it's for the chemoreceptors that are on the tongue to help them to locate food or locate mates. So they're looking for different chemical signals to signal, okay, there could be food nearby, there could be sensing some pheromones of a potential mate nearby. So once we get into the mouth, then if we're going to travel down the digestive system, we have the esophagus. So the esophagus for most vertebrates is connecting the mouth to the stomach. Some reptiles have a really long esophagus to accommodate large prey, and some have esophageal teeth to cut shells. So lots of snakes and lizards like to eat eggs of other species. And so you swallow an egg, that's a hard kind of shell. What do you do with it then? If you bite an egg, it's harder to get all of the nutrition from it. So you swallow it and then bite it inside. Genius, right? Esophageal teeth to cut shells. It's a pretty wild adaptation. So the stomach is elongated in lizards and snakes, again, because of their body plan and because of the size of the prey that they ingest. There's a cecum in many reptiles. So that's kind of an extra organ that secretes digestive enzymes, and it can help digest plant matter in herbivorous reptiles. There are separate compartments in reptiles for the intestinal and the urogenital tracts, but they still have just one exit, which is the cloaca, also called the vent. So once you go esophagus and then stomach, small intestine, large intestine, and then cloacal opening. Rectum is often another word for large intestine, then cloacal opening. Nervous system of reptiles. So some reptiles have cutaneous receptors to receive information about heat and also to sense pain. So these are pit vipers have these pits here. You can see them here. This one actually, this species has multiple different pits for receptors. This is another pit viper with a pit. And so those are heat sensing. So they can detect even 1/100th of a degree in temperature change. So they can, even if the air temperature is pretty warm, they can find warm-blooded animals using those pits. So it really helps them to find prey. Reptiles have ears. Sometimes you can see them, sometimes you can't. You can see ear holes on this skink. Helps them both with hearing and with maintaining equilibrium. Snakes, you don't see their external ear openings. There are some that have an exposed tympanum closer to what you'd see like in frogs. There are some reptiles that have a nictitating membrane, kind of like the frog, where it comes up so they can see through, especially those that are aquatic. Some reptiles have what's called lacrimal glands that secrete tears. So if they're in like a sandy environment and there might be debris that gets in the eyes, those tears can help clear it away. And then some reptiles, some lizards have what's called a parietal organ or a parietal eye. People like to think of it as a third eye. It helps to regulate body temperature mostly. There's actually a lot of research on what it actually does. There's some hypotheses that it does other things. It's cool to think that it might, but we're pretty sure that it helps to regulate body temperature. So can you describe the structures and functions of the integumentary, skeletal, cardiovascular, respiratory, digestive, and nervous systems in reptiles? If not, circle back, check out parts of the video that you need to review again. Otherwise, I'll leave you with a far side. Seeing this made me think, can a snake actually eat a cow? And so of course I Google it, and you'll have to look for yourself on YouTube. What I found was oftentimes they attempt and then have to regurgitate. So probably it's happened that snakes have eaten a small cow, but a lot of times it's a failed attempt. So sometimes they get a hold of prey and then let it go again. All right, I'll see you guys in class. Thanks for watching.